decoding GSM transmissions. I'm also author of Multi-RTL. This is a multi-channel receiver based on cheap RTL-SDR receivers. I'm also working at Warsaw University of Technology, and I'm trying to finish my PhD on GSM-based passive radar there. And I'm also a free software fan. Maybe I'm not always perfect free software fan because I'm using Ubuntu or Google Groups for hosting mailing lists or a GitHub. So, but I can swear I will be better in the future. So, gr-gsm, what is it? It's an out of three GNU radio module. And how many of you have heard about GNU radio? Can you raise hands? Okay. Okay, great. So I don't have to explain too much about GNU radio. And this, as I said, is a set of tools for receiving, demultiplexing, and decoding GSM transmissions. Together with Wireshark, it enables live analysis, for example, of GSM transmissions, but also more. The project page is in here. If you want, you can visit it and see what is it about. If someone has any doubt what the UM radio link is, it's the link between mobile stations and base stations, and the gr-gsm goal is about to passively, at this moment at least, to passively listen to this link. So, about the gr-gsm history, to explain how it started, we have to go back a few years, exactly 9 years, when first works on receiving GSM started. And what was motivating people in 2007 to start working on receiving GSM? One of the arguments was that there is more GSM terminals than nodes connected to internet, yet we don't have access to GSM physical layer and we can't do any security research on GSM. And it's a situation, opposite situation than in internet security research where we can, for example, sniff any Ethernet frames that we want, or we can even inject any Ethernet frames that we want. And knowledge of GSM was very rare at that time, not only in free software community where it was almost known, but also in commercial entities where only a handful of people knew how to implement different parts of GSM, and especially physical layer. So about GSM security, there were tons of security weaknesses that were waiting for exploitation. And for example, there is no base station authentication in GSM, and this is exploited to this day by security apparatus. You probably have heard about IMSI catchers. I don't have to ask this question probably in this audience. And I added here a very comically weak algorithm securing the main key that is stored on a SIM card. This was broken exactly like in USA action movies, where you break one part of the key, one digit by another. And this is exactly how breaking of this algorithm worked. And this was already replaced in 2007, but it was very funny, so I wanted to say it here. And the design of the main algorithm that was securing all of the signals transmitted by users in GSM was very weak. It is based still on linear feedback shift registers that are easily, quite easily modeled mathematically. So you can have a lot of theoretical and not theoretical mathematical attacks. It's also vulnerable to time memory trade-off, and this was successfully used by Karsten Noh later to break GSM and show that it can be broken. And already in 2007, if you search on the internet that you want to capture and decipher GSM transmissions, you could find a lot of commercial offers that were offered to government entities. Yet GSM carriers were living in denial that GSM is insecure. They, for example, made an argument, they presented as a security measure difficulty to receive GSM signal. And this was working like red rag on a bull, I should say, because many works were started in 2007. And why GSM is insecure? It's interesting to ask this question because first let's start that there is long tradition of collusion of telecommunication companies with government against interest of end users or people, if you will. And the telecommunication companies have this collusion deeply in their DNA. And this dates back to time of times where they were national telecommunication monopolies, but it also continues to this day. And why is this collusion such profitable? Because power of telecommunication companies highly depends on power of governments who regulate telecommunication companies on the one side, and power of governments also somehow depends on telecommunication companies because they make it possible to surveil the citizens. So this is good cooperation for both sides. And one of the examples of this collusion is nearly symbiotic relation of AT&T and NSA. It was unraveled by in Politico article that was co-written with Laura Poitras in 2015 from analysis of NSA's own documents. And for example, NSA said about its confidential partner that it's extremely, extremely helpful. And looking back to GSM, committee who created GSM in the 1980s was more concerned with possibility of users having too high security, not too low. And this was shown, first said by Ross Anderson from his talks with some confidential persons who were in this committee, and then by these people themselves in an article from 2014 that was not long after Snowden revelations. They came out and said that British wanted 48-bit key for securing GSM transmissions on behalf of their security agency, GCHQ, and as they are Five Eyes country, also on behalf of NSA. And the creators of GSM, people credited with creating GSM, said that they wanted 128-bit key. So you can see that it ended much more closer to what British wanted, because we end up with 54 bits, where there were 64 bits of key, but last 10 bits were zeroed. And there there were also French who didn't want encryption at all. So we have a special mode in GSM of encrypting that doesn't encrypt at all. It's an unencrypted transmission, and it's called French mode. And we have also deliberately weakened A52 ciphering algorithm that was meant for export for disliked countries. And also each phone had an option to switch off the encryption by the operator, and the user wouldn't be notified of it. By design, it was required that he shouldn't be notified. And on top of that, we have security through obscurity. So it's a great combination of security measures. So in this atmosphere, in 2007, THC, the Hacker's Choice project for breaking GSM was started, and it needed software for receiving. So three sub-projects were written by different people. There was gr-gsm by Joshua Lackey, gr-gsm-sp, that I don't know who is author of it, and gr-gsm-void by Tempest Void, who was the most advanced one in that time, and it was because it had automatic frequency offset correction and simple equalization to fight inter-symbol interferences. But at the beginning of 2009, THC project unexpectedly ended. And there were many rumors that there were black vans or bugs with money for buying the authors. We don't know why it ended, but the work on GSM Sniffer was continued under APRO project. And my part started in the mid-2009 when I have written GSM receiver. I wanted to, my motivation to addition to that security related ones were to show that I can, because I was studying telecommunication at that time, and I was at the end of my studies, and I still didn't implement anything. I only worked on theoretical stuff and wanted to show that I can do something real. So I created GSM receiver that was working more like it was intended by the GSM creators. It used training sequences from burst to estimate channel impulse response, and used this channel impulse response to counter inter-symbol interferences with Viterbi equalization algorithm. It also included at the beginning, when I added it to the APRO project, decoding of control channels, common control channel, and traffic channel. This was hacked on top of GSM receiver very fast, and it was supposed to be as fast removed, but somehow it left in there. And the code was also parsed by Harald Welte and Sylvain Munaut to add ability to analyze the messages in Wireshark, and they also added support for decoding other control channels. As I said, it was at that time the most popular part of the APRO, but it had some drawbacks, because and I have to say that these were my errors. There were never removed temporary hacks, and GSM receiver was meant for receiving GSM burst only. and the coding and other stuff meant to be done somewhere else. And there were also unresolved problems that were residing in my code. The frequency correction loop, the stuff for correcting frequency offset wasn't working very well. It was over some time, it tended to be unstable and never went back to working. Again, you would have to restart the program again to make it work. And there was also not working synchronization of bursts inside the TDMA frames. So there are two schemes of how bursts can be put in the TDMA frame, and GSM receiver had hard-coded one of them and couldn't receive the other one, or couldn't also receive uplink bursts where this synchronization is very needed. And this is from talk of Domi from 3 years ago from this camp. And at some point, GSM receiver gave errors like this. So this is exactly loss of synchronization due to this bug, the first bug. And at some point, development of GSM receiver stopped. I didn't have for some period, I didn't have time to work on it. And then in 2011, OSMoco BB project was announced and very soon released. And OSMoco BB, what is it? It's implementation of GSM transceiver with use of Calypso-based phones that you can buy for not so much on eBay, for example. And it wasn't using general purpose software-defined radio hardware like the previous project GSM receiver include used. And Calypso phones are much cheaper than SDR hardware that GSM receiver was using. So my motivation at that moment almost evaporated, although I made some attempts to restart, but unsuccessful. But in the end of 2013, I discovered that people are still using GSM receiver. They find it usable, and I are quite happy with it, despite its flaws. Maybe they just didn't know they exist. And using it with cheap RTL-SDR receivers that I thought are good as toys for kids, not real SDR receivers. But somehow it was working. So I made another attempt to correct my bugs from GSM receiver, this time almost successful ones, because I corrected synchronization. And the other problem with frequency correction loops instability, I solved by removing it initially. And you would have to correct the frequency offset manually. So at that moment, I wanted to push my changes to April project and maybe become its maintainer. But the project was unmaintained to the point that it was not possible to find anyone who had access to the repository. So I decided that it's easy to start a project on a GitHub, so I just started a gr-gsm project in April 2014. And this is how it got born. So gr-gsm, what is it currently? The main part is a block for receiving GSM transmissions, and without the bloat, the quick hacks added to decrypt and decode the burst. And it currently supports frequency hopping and uplink demodulation, although it's not added in applications yet. It has also modular design. It has separate blocks for the multiplexing of logical channels and separate blocks for decoding. It also makes use of new GNU Radio capabilities such as message passing and stream tags. And it also have applications from the start for scanning, live analysis of broadcast channel, GSM broadcast channel, and decoding of signal file stored to a disk that is a bit more flexible than this live analysis. And there are, as I said, still some capabilities that are not covered by out-of-the-box applications. So a quick introduction about GSM to let someone who didn't have anything to do with it feel what is it. The signal, GSM signal, is divided into TDMA frames that have 8 time slots inside. Each time slot is 156.25 symbols long, and with the sampling rate of GSM, it gives 577 microseconds per time slot. If you look at the real signal from the GSM broadcast channel, it looks like this. The envelope of the signal is constant with one exception. Between each burst, there is a guard period when the signal power goes down. So these guard periods are separating each time slot here. And this is the broadcast channel here. So all of the bursts have the same power, and in each time slot there is a burst. For other channels, it isn't the case. Bursts are only transmitted with when they are needed, and with power that is needed. So the powers can be different in different time slots. There are 4 bursts that you can see on the downlink of GSM, and this is normal bursts that carry all users' data, and then 3 bursts that are only present on the broadcast channel, and this is frequency correction burst for correcting frequency offset, synchronization burst for time synchronization, and dummy burst for filling empty spaces when there is nothing to transmit. And after each burst, there is guard period of 8.25 symbols. And in GSM, time slot is a physical channel. It's treated as physical channel on which multiple so-called logical channels are transmitted in some predefined groups. And one of the examples is traffic channel and slow associated control channel combination. So if you put subsequent time slots in columns, you will have these physical channels in rows. And here there is this combination that repeats every 26 frames. So here we have empty space at the end of this combination, and we have these traffic channels. They are carrying voice of users, and slow associated control channel that carries some call related stuff like power control or timing advance, so user can adjust when he transmits or how powerful should be this transmission. And the other special group that is typical to broadcast channel is this one that is always transmitted in the first time slot of broadcast channel. And it consists of frequency correction bursts. After one frame, there is synchronization burst. Then there is broadcast control channel that carries configuration of base station. And then there are common control channels that are used by users to paging them, to assign them some other channels. And now, what are elements of gr-gsm? The main one is the receiver that transforms oversampled GSM signal into GSM bursts. And the signal is usually four times oversampled over that sampling rate that I shown before. And on the first input, it takes broadcast channel, and it works according to very simple algorithm. It first looks for frequency correction burst, then for synchronization burst. When frequency synchronization burst is found, it looks for synchronization burst. And if it finds it and decodes it correctly, it goes to synchronous burst processing, when it just put on the output all bursts that it can demodulate. And it also uses frequency correction burst to compute carrier frequency offset measurements, and it uses synchronization burst to keep the synchronization. And in an event of loss of synchronization, everything goes to the first point. So everything restarts. And currently, this block can process frequency hopping and uplink, but this isn't included in the apps yet. So this is how it looks in GNU Radio Companion, the GNU Radio graphical user interface. And it, in this case, it has one input for the broadcast channel, and it always have three outputs, one for broadcast channel burst, and the next one for other channels burst, and the last one for carrier frequency offset measurements. The next part is reference clock drift correction loop. Why to do something like this? It's because the receivers that are available for everyone usually use quite bad clock sources. In case of RTL-SDR, its dongles, its inaccuracy of clock can be like 80 points per million, and it changes with time and temperature, so you can just measure it one time and then use the value later. And the GSM needs accuracy of 1 point per million, so there is needed some way to correct it. And the frequency correction loop corrects two effects of clock frequency offset, and these effects are carrier frequency offset and also sampling frequency offset, because all frequencies in receivers are usually derived from a common clock, and its error affects these both things. And how this loop looks like? We have the receiver, clock offset control block, and a block in which I put some other blocks for convenience to keep the flow graphs smaller. And the block that is interesting for this carrier frequency offset correction, for clock offset correction, is this block in here. So the GSM receiver measures carrier frequency offset. It sends it to the clock offset control block. If this block decides that clock offset frequency needs to be corrected, it sends control message to the clock offset corrector tag. And this block, clock offset corrector block. And this block have inside two blocks, one for correcting carrier frequency offset and the other one for correcting sample frequency offset. And then there are in gr-gsm blocks for demultiplexing of logical channels that look into burst header for information such as frame number and time slot number. They filter bursts coming from a given time slot, and they set correct channel types based on frame number and particular combination of logical channels that is used. It also they also group bursts for decoders so that are later, so they always get the right number of bursts to decode. And this is how they look like. You have demapper. This is how I call these demultiplexing blocks. Demapper for broadcast channel plus common control channel, and for standalone dedicated channel that usually carries call setup messages and SMSs, for example. And the next one is for traffic channel, the mapping, which it has two outputs, one for traffic bursts and other one for slow associated control channel bursts. And then if the transmission is encrypted, it can be decrypted with use of decryption block that supports all of the algorithms that are used in GSM, and this is thanks to Osmo Core from OS Mocom. And they have two options. One is session key, and the other one is version of the encryption algorithm that is used. Then the next blocks are decoding blocks that currently support control channel decoding and traffic full rate traffic channel decoding. And example of flow graph that does decoding looks like this. And these decoders at the output give messages in GNU radios, in special GNU radio format. It's called PDU message, that it can be connected to some other GNU radio blocks that support this format. And this is how decoding of full rate traffic channels that carry voice data looks like. One of the outputs in the traffic channel decoder is for fast associated control channel, and the other one is for voice frames in here. And also with these blocks, range of GNU radio sinks and sources can be used. As a source, any block that provides GSM signal can be used, like files, OS Mocom source for RTL, UHD source for ETUS, USRP, any block that can provide GSM signal. And on the other side of the sinks, socket PDU can be used for sending messages, GSM messages over the network, so they can be analyzed in, for example, Wireshark. And voice data can be stored to normal files, and there are also some blocks for presentation of messages and bursts that can be connected somewhere in the flow graph, and they will show what bits are in the burst and maybe frame number of the burst, and also content of the message, of the decoded message. This is how full flow graph that can do some work looks like. This one decodes broadcast channel messages, and it prints it on the standard output and send it over network, so it can be seen in Wireshark. And here I have some live demo of this flow graph. I try to make more space. So it's only slightly different from that what I shown. It has some block to make frequency shifting. So, for example, DC offset can be removed. And on the other side, it has such decoding blocks. And it has additional socket PDU for receiving the packets, so some additional ECMP packets are not generated. So now I will run it. Okay, so you can see GSM signal in here. And there are also GSM messages printed by message printer in here. And then it's everything working live currently. And then you can see this in Wireshark. I will close this one and open another one. Okay. So there are more and more of these messages. For example, there is system information type 3 message that carries information about the operator. So you can see that it's Telenor, Hungary. We are in Hungary. We have location area and identifier of the base station in here. Okay, I will close it for now. But I have another demo for this part that presents how frequency offset correction loop works, what it does for correcting sampling frequency offset in this case. What I did here, I printed time slots in rows. So the pixels in rows represent amplitude of inside of time slots. And here there is a part where the amplitude is lower. These are guard periods. And why this is on its side and it moves to the left is because sample rate is a bit too high and a bit too low in this case, and bursts are too short, so each burst is a bit shorter than the previous one. And this guard period doesn't appear in place when it should. So after frequency correction, as you can see, guard periods are always in the same position. If they move, it's very slowly. I can add some frequency offset in here and look if it still works, and it works. Okay, there are some plans for the future, like packaging the project, and it's almost done. I have to figure out some licensing stuff so it can make it into Debian. There is also much needed writing of documentation that I always don't have time to do. There is adding half rate traffic channel support. We have missing demapping and decoding for this to work, but it should be fairly easy because it will be in libosmocore. I don't know if you have seen, osmocore project is under heavy development currently. I haven't seen it under that heavy development before. And there is also a possibility to change decoders, so they have soft input, so some bit error rate can be improved in here. And applications should be improved because the scanning app currently, for example, runs one scan, then throws the GNU radio flow graph away and creates another one and then starts again, and this is quite slow. There are also some false positives that sometimes appear during scanning, and this should be corrected. And decoding for uplink and hopping channels could also be added, but I haven't done it yet, also because I have some moral dilemmas in here, if I should do this for all these kiddies that are waiting for this. The receiver could be made more modular, so it can be easy. The testing of it could be easier, and it could be different apps could be built with its parts. Benchmarking of bit error rate of the demodulation also could be very helpful, because currently I don't know how far it is from the ideal. And also frequency correction burst detection could be improved, so it works in lower signal to noise ratio, and carrier frequency offset estimation could also be more accurate. But it isn't so bad currently. And also there is a big plan to add ability to transmit bursts in the future, but here there is lack of good hardware that could transmit and wouldn't cost a lot at the same time. So this is main obstacle in here. If it would work, it will be at the beginning with USRPs, I think. So if you find anything in here that you are good at, you can go to the project page and clone the repository and then send back some changes. I will happily accept them. So then we have another project from the title of the presentation, Multi-RTL. So Multi-RTL is, as I said, a multi-channel receiver based on RTL-SDR receivers. And why I worked on something like this. I wanted to make it possible for the gr-gsm users to receive multiple bands synchronously without having to buy some expensive hardware like USRPs or some other that costs hundreds of dollars or euros. Usually it would have to be done with quite expensive multi-channel or wideband equipment. So I was looking for a solution, not very actively looking, but I had it back in my mind. So there was a hack presented by Juha Virinen, I think, did it first. He synchronized frequency of two dongles by This is his photo. By replacing oscillator on one of the receivers and feeding the oscillation signal from the other dongle. It's a hack. Maybe it's not the most correctly done, but it works and it's very cheap modification. You don't need any additional hardware to do this. However, there was no synchronization in time. And the main ideas how to synchronize in time were centered around adding some electronic circuits that generate noise and inject it at some given moment to our receivers. So based on this signal, we can it would be possible to measure time difference between each of the dongle. And possible applications of such solution are direction finding, beamforming, or passive radar, but it's not enough for receiving in multiple bands. But what if RTL-SDRs kept synchronization after changing the central frequency? Somehow, I didn't see anybody asking this question, and it would be good to check it, because why wouldn't it keep synchronization? So I did some quick test to check it, and I used the signal I know very well, so GSM signal, which has very regular amplitude due to these guard periods in each time slot. So the test was following started receiving on some given central frequency of GSM signal, then switched to some channel where nothing was transmitted, and then switched back to the same GSM signal. And I was looking if the time structure of the signal is kept, if nothing is being shifted. And here I did like on the previous plots that I've shown, I put time slots in rows, and here we have time, slow time. And guard periods are this part when the amplitude of the signal is lower. And after two retunings, the guard periods are still aligned. And for every test recording I made, this was the case. So hooray, synchronization was kept. And what's next? It would be good to avoid building additional electronics, because it puts entry level for other people a bit higher than without it. So I thought that there are many signals available in air that could be used for finding time difference between the receivers. And knowing the previous finding, we could tune to one frequency for some signal that gives us good enough accuracy of estimating time differences between the receivers, and then switch to any frequency that all of the receivers to any frequency that we want. And this is how I created Multi-RTL block. It's a GNU radio hierarchical block which have under the hood many OSMOCOM RTL SDR sources, as many as there are channels, and the block have similar set of options as OSMOCOM source. The difference is that I removed some options that have no use for RTL SDR sources. And the project page is in here. If you want, go there and check it. The block has also additional additional set of options for synchronization, and this is synchronization frequency and gain of each channel during the synchronization. And as for the hardware, it's basically hardware with you have your Inans hardware mode that you can see here or in here. And with this mode, you can make up to three channel receiver before it stops working. And the procedure according to which the multi-RTL works is following. It first is tuning RTL-SDR dongles to the same frequency with the signal that is used for synchronization. Then the short period of signal is recorded from each of the dongles. On this signal, on a signal of one of the dongles and all of the others, cross-correlation is computed. Then maximum of each of cross-correlation is found, and from this we know time difference from this one selected input to all of the others, and we can correct them. And then after correction, receivers are switched to target frequencies, and other parameters like gains are also changed to target values. So here is how example of GSM signal cross-correlation, autocorrelation looks like, and it's cross-correlation of two signal from two inputs, and its maximum is a bit shifted from zero, and this shift is time delay of two of these two dongles that were used for recording this signal. Knowing it, we can correct it. This is an example of how multi-RTL works on GSM signal. So at the beginning, there is short period when the part of the signal is recorded, then the block computes the time difference and corrects it. So these guard periods are in the same position in for both inputs. This is one of the inputs, and this is plot for the second input. And from starting from here, the inputs are synchronized. So what are plans for the future with multi-RTL? I would want to make it coherent for everyone, so phase on each channel is kept and it's not not changing. And this is not the case because some mechanism to tune more with greater resolution the receivers is used. And the effect of this algorithm is that two RTL-SDRs tuned to the same frequency can still have some frequency offset between them. So this was already done. The change is waiting for including it in the mainline RTL-SDR driver in OSMOCOM project, but somehow this driver looks a bit unmaintained at the moment. So this change was done like 2 years ago. I don't remember exactly, but quite a long time. And it would be good to resynchronize automatically whenever synchronization is lost. Currently, OSMOCOM source doesn't give any information that it is the case, so users would have to call the resynchronization method of multi-RTL manually. So it would be good to have it done automatically. Okay, and now some demos. How I'm doing the test recording myself, I'm storing it signal to a disk, recording with USRP of any kind of or RTL-SDR, and I'm using also my own phone to make a call or send an SMS, and then I'm trying to receive it. And for this, as a phone, I'm using old Nokia 3310 that comes with a FBUS cable that enables me to take some interesting logs out of it, like messages that the phone is receiving, or SIM messages that phone sends between himself and SIM. And many things can be easier with such source of additional information. Of course, you can be brave and not use something like this, but it will be a bit, just a bit harder. So this is the phone, if you don't remember it. And how can we obtain session encryption key, so-called KC key? You can generate it with SIM card. There was a very good blog post by Domi about it, how to do many methods, how to do it. You can crack it with Kraken. You can also get it from Nokia phone.
As far as I experienced that, with my Nokia phone, exactly the key part was omitted from the messages. Were you successful getting it from?
Yeah,
really?
I can show it because it isn't shown in Wireshark as message carrying a key. It's some unknown message. So I will show it. So first you have to search for GSM algorithm message. Then there is get response sent to the card, and then the next SIM message is with, oh, I have to connect the power because the presentation will end. Is it still working? Okay. So this is how it goes. First, there is run algorithm message sent from the phone. Then there is get response, and then there is response that has some strange description. But last 8 bytes of it carry the session key. Yeah, this is how it is. And I have some demos here. For example, getting a voice from GSM downlink. And now, this particular capture was my first capture that I did in February 2009, so it's quite old. And I posted it on the APROBE in in decrypted form. I posted it on the APROBE mailing list, and I waited for someone answering. And this is what was inside. Ah, voices. So some synthesizer reading some stuff. Yeah, and the last part, congratulations, you are the winner, was for Dieter Sparf, who was first to decode this capture. And then he said to me how he did it, told me how he did it, and I reproduced it in the GSM receiver. Okay. Then, as for multi-RTL, I have a capture of an SMS from uplink, and this for capturing I used flow graph like this with two channels and with storing to files, signal to files, and then I processed it offline with this flow graph that has two inputs in here, number of streams one, and I have also training sequence for some reason, and then I have part for decoding standalone dedicated channel that carries the SMS. There is a decryption block with entered the session key, and it outputs to the Wireshark. So I will show what will appear in Wireshark now. So it decodes something and it ends. What we get is this. At some moment there is an SMS from mobile station to the network in here, and we can see what's inside also Wireshark. There is some user data, and this is test SMS, some numbers, and it was exactly what was sent. There is also number, but don't call it, I don't use it. Okay. The next demonstration is getting voice from uplink and downlink that have frequency hopping. For frequency hopping, people are asking me how I am using it, so I'm showing it here. There are how to know on which frequencies the given base station transmits, and this is carried inside system information type 1 message. I will show it. In the Wireshark, system information type 3. There is control channel description, system information type 1, it should be. Cell channel description, there is list of RFCNs. These are channels that are used by this base station that was recorded. And then, and how to get other hopping parameters? They are inside of immediate assignment and assignment commands. Immediate assignments are assigning standalone dedicated channel, and assignment commands are usually assigning traffic channels. So I will show them. I will try to show them. Immediate assignment. It assigns a dedicated channel with frequency hopping on time slot 0 with mobile allocation index offset 0 and hopping sequence number 0 in this case. And then assignment command. And here there is also mobile allocation, and this is just selection of this channels that I shown before from system information message So these are three of them, and it happens that the last three of them. And then assignment command. It's only a bit different. It repeats the list of channels and mobile allocation, and it also have a channel description with hopping parameters in here. So this is what I use to configure flow graphs in gr-gsm. So now let's go to the. Okay, so first what I did, I recorded both uplink and downlink of the transmission. I recorded full spectrum of the network operation operator, because I could do that. And then I found out which channels are used. I used GSM channelizer helper script that you can find in gr-gsm. This is how it invocation of it look like. In the end, there is list of channels that should be extracted. So I used it on the uplink part and on the downlink part. I had 8 files in the result. I connected it to the GSM receiver, which have 4 input streams. And this is the receiver with uplink. So there are 4 more for the uplink. There is also the list, the cell allocation that is filled in here. And yes, and the bursts are stored to files, so I could process them later in another flow graph. And example of this flow graph is in here. First block on which does the hopping algorithm is this channel hopper block. And it has input parameters, as it inputs parameters, a list of mobile allocation channels from the messages to allocate channels, mobile allocation index offset, and the hopping parameters generally. And it works just by filtering bursts that are coming to its input, and its output, if they fit the description, it sends it to the output. And then there is demapper for traffic channel. Here is its output for traffic channels. They get the burst get decrypted, and then uplink and downlink is splitted into 2 parts with 2 separate paths to decode them and play them in GNU radio without running any external player, because there is a block in GNU radio for decoding full rate GSM audio. And now I will run it. So at the beginning it processes some bursts, because there was quite long period between I started the moment I started recording and there was the call. There are some bursts coming. This is because parity check let them through. Yeah, this is voicemail message that voicemail is full. And there is also my voice in the uplink that is barely heard in here. So I will play it from a file, because it was written to a file in here. Okay. And I can play it in PLC. Wow. Yeah, this is me saying test, test, test. I was making a lot of these recordings and I didn't have anything more creative to say at some moment. Yeah, this is the uplink part. Yeah, sure. And yeah, this is the end. I was hoping to show live demo of decoding, but there is no base station, so I will leave this at this moment. Let's go back to the presentation. The part is questions and answers. Who's got some question?
I've been trying to do this trick with the connecting the two SDRs on the same crystal, and have you managed to find a pinout for the SDR chip somehow? Because
no, I haven't tried. I just used the hack from the internet.
Yeah, and mine was just a bit different than I could make an analogy.
Yeah, I for example would like to put some more accurate oscillator, but I don't know how yet. Maybe more questions? No, so maybe I was too clear. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.